I'm Stefanie. I'm a faculty in CSAIL and EECS at MIT, and my work is in machine learning. And in particular, my group is looking at how can we do machine learning with combinatorial input. So what does that actually mean? It kind of means, what if we want to predict not only a label, like someone may have a disease or not, or maybe someone will purchase something or not, but what if we want to predict a set of items that someone may, for example, like? Or what if our input is a more structured object, for example, a molecule or a network of interactions? Can we make predictions on those kinds of objects, and how do we do it? This is what we look at in our research. Our goal is really to make machine learning much more widely applicable, to make it more reliable and robust. So what we actually look at is, can we actually prove that the things work? And can we actually find the limits of the methods that people are currently using? And can we improve over those? And we are looking at these more general objects to learn with, just because that widely increases the applications of machine learning, where we can actually use it. Just think of machine learning in the traditional setting is that we take a set of measurements. For example, we have some information about you, we have some information about your age, your demographics, maybe some things you like, and we try to make a prediction. Or we have some information about your habits, and we're trying to make a prediction whether you're at risk for getting a certain disease. So now what if what we actually have is, for example, a molecule or a material that is actually not a set of measurements, it's actually something much more complex. It's atoms, and you have bonds between these atoms, you have some information about all of this. Can we actually make a prediction whether this molecule will work as a drug? Can we try to predict whether this will be toxic, whether it'll work for certain things that we wanted as a material? So now that becomes a much more complex problem, because now we have to actually take this molecule and somehow encode it in a way that it looks like as if we had just taken a set of measurements. And how we do this greatly affects on what we can actually learn with it, and it's not yet fully clear how to do this, and this is one example of what we're working on. Obviously, this greatly increases the number of applications of machine learning, because being able to make predictions from such more complex interactive structures is something that we can just use in many more applications. Examples are materials designed, finding new materials, trying to make predictions how we actually synthesize them, or in chemistry, trying to make predictions about what the properties are of different molecules, how they would react with each other, and things like that. So for this specific technology, there's lots of real-world applications in chemistry, actually computational chemistry and drug design. So just the question of how do I actually encode a molecule or a material to make learning possible with it. So that's very important, say, if I want to develop drugs, if I want to actually be able to predict whether something will work as a drug. Drug screening is super expensive. Same for other types of materials that I want to develop. So anything that can already help me pre-screen some of these and make predictions on which ones will be better than others, that can actually greatly help me in reducing the empirical cost of actually making these experiments. So that's one big application area. Another one that's also related to pharmacy and medical is interactions between proteins or drugs or so. So now my network is not actually the molecule itself, it's actually each entity in this network is a molecule or a protein, and now I'm looking at interactions between them. So you could think of interactions between drugs, and I want to predict whether if I take these two drugs together they actually will have bad side effects. And that's a very important thing to predict. It's very expensive to actually find this out, because there's so many different combinations of drugs, and finding this from clinical data is actually very expensive, doing all these experiments. So anything that can help you, even pre-screening and making some predictions on what may be the ones that are more likely to interact, will greatly help actually reduce the cost. So that's one example of applications. Another one that we're working on is making structured predictions in terms of, now again in material science, now I want to make a certain material. Can I actually try to predict on how I would make it? Can I predict some properties of the synthesis paths that are relevant? And that's again where I can use machine learning, and where I actually need these structured inputs and outputs to make the right predictions. So I think some of the parts that I talked about are very relevant for anyone trying to do design of materials, design of drugs, pharmacy companies. But what you can also do is you can encode interactions and make predictions about interactions. So this may be important for companies that analyze transactions, interactions between customers, interactions between other types of items, maybe transportation networks. These are inputs that are graphs. What you can also do is analyze configurations. So people have been using this also for analyzing configurations of drones that fly. So here you have relations of who's close to each other. And you could think of various other contexts where you have a collection of items and you're trying to predict sort of what is a good way to pose them, for example. There's many cool things about working at CSAIL. One big thing is the opportunities. Like, I feel like I can do anything if I just want it, if I just have the idea. So I have the privilege to really work with some super smart students, to have some really good colleagues, and sort of the best opportunities I could have for actually doing some great research. So I really, really like this. It's a super active environment, and I think this is one thing about MIT that stands out, is that there's that atmosphere of creativity and the atmosphere of like trying to do something and the energy in the place. Like everyone wants to do something, everyone is busy, and that's very inspiring to me to do actually more research and to have better ideas.